Okay, welcome to the data science programming class. In this week 6, we are going to learn about the data manipulation with pandas. So in this part, we will discuss about the pandas library, and we will divide into three parts. Yeah, so in this week 6, we are going to learn about the part 1, and in the week 7 and week 8, we will learn about the part 2 and part 3. So we will start from the data manipulation with pandas in part 1. Okay, we are going to introduce about the pandas object. Yeah, before we use the pandas library, we need to understand what is pandas object first. Then after that, we will try to implement the pandas library using Python programming language. Okay, at the very basic level, pandas object can be thought of as an enhanced version of NumPy. Structure arrays in which the rows and columns are identified with labels rather than simple integer indices. So it means if we use the pandas library, it differs with the NumPy's library, because in the pandas library, we have a flexible indexes. So for example, if we use the pandas library, we create a pandas variables, we can define the index with the string index, for example. It differs with the NumPy libraries. It different with NumPy variables, because if we use the NumPy variables, we only be able to use the integer index, not the string index, right? So we can say that it's more simple if we compare with the NumPy variables. And pandas provides a host of useful tools, methods, and functionality on top of the basic data structures. But nearly everything that follows will require an understanding of what these structures are. Yeah, we know that pandas library have a lot of function, have a lot of useful tools, but it requires to understand for us about the basic pandas objects. So if you want to use the pandas library, we need to understand how to use it, right? So yeah, it requires a lot of understanding how to use each of these tools features that is provided by the pandas library. And there are three fundamental pandas data structures. We can call it a series, data frame, and index. Yeah, we will start from the series. Okay, what is series? A pandas series is a one-dimensional array of index data. So it means it's like one-dimensional array. Yeah, it's similar with the NumPy array. Yeah, one-dimensional NumPy array is similar with it, but we have some differences, and we will discuss it after this. A pandas series can be created using the following constructor. Yeah, we can use the pandas.series. We call the series method, and inside this method, we have some parameters: data, index, data type, and copy. So it means data. It means the array that we want to convert to the pandas series. And the index, it means we can use the custom index for pandas libraries, for pandas variables. So it means we can use our custom index. Yeah, it's not only integer index, we can also use the string index. Yeah. And the third parameter is the D type. So it means the data type of the pandas variable. And the last one is copy. It means we can use our pandas variable as an immutable array. So it means if we the last parameters, the copy parameters, we can only set to true or false. So it means if we set to true, so our pandas variable, our series variable, we will not be able to change. Yeah, we cannot change the values or the items inside the pandas series if we set to true. But by default, the copy values will be false. So it means we can change the item inside our pandas series. Okay. So we can create a pandas series by using the following code. Yeah, so for example, we will create a one-dimensional pandas variables, or we can call it as a series. Yeah, So pandas series, it means pandas variable which have a one dimensional array. So it means data equal pd.series. So these are the item inside our pandas series, and we can print the data like this. So we can just copy this code into our Google Colab. So we will use this one. So we can copy this code, yeah. Okay. So if we print, we will have the item with its index. So yeah, because we don't set the parameters for the index and also the D type, yeah, and also the copy. So it means we only set the data parameters. So by default, yeah, the index will be start from 0 to 2n. Yeah, it depends on the how many item that we have, yeah, because we only have 4 items. So it means we have a 4 item inside our pandas series. And the D type by default, because we have a decimal numbers in our item, so it means we will have a D type as a float 64. And the last one, the copy, the default value will be false. So it means we can change, yeah, we can change the item, we can update the item inside our pandas series, yeah, because by default it will be set to false. Okay, how about if we want to print only for the item? So we can just print only in the values, data.values. So if we print data.values, it will print only the item. Okay, if you want to print only the index, yeah, we can use the data.index like this. Data.index. If we print, it will show you the index, yeah. The index start from 0, stop to 4, yeah. So it means we start from 0, 1, 2, and 3, and the step will be 1, yeah. So these are the code that useful for printing the values and also the index. Okay, so the next one is, yeah. Like with a NumPy array, data can be accessed by the associated index via the familiar Python square bracket notation. So it means we can print the data, the item inside our pandas series, by using the indexing that is similar with the Python collection, and also it's similar with the NumPy variables, yeah. So because we don't set the index, yeah, by default, it will start from 0 to n, yeah. It depends on how many items that we have. So if we want to print the data, yeah, the data start from 1, yeah, I mean, I want to print the data in index 1. I want to print the item inside our pandas series in index 1. So yeah, it's similar with the NumPy variables. We can just use the index like this. Okay. And we can also use the slicing similar with NumPy variables. Yeah. If we want to get the item from index 1 to index 2, so we can use this code. Yeah, print data. So I can just copy this one. Print data 1, 2, 3 like this. So it means we will get the item start from index 1 to index 2. Okay, it's similar with the NumPy variables. And you can also, yeah, one of the advantages of pandas series over NumPy is that the pandas series is much more general and flexible than the one dimensional NumPy array that it emulates. So it means we can, like I was mentioning before, we can create our custom index, yeah, for indexing the item in our pandas series. So we can just use another code here. So I can just copy this one. Okay, so it means we create a pandas series and we have a 5. So it means 5 is not how many item that in our pandas series. So it means all the item inside our pandas series will be 5. And for the index, we set our custom index. Index equal 100, 200, and 300. So it means we have 3 items inside our pandas series. And the index will be 100, 200, and 300. So we can create our index, yeah, our index. So we will not start from 0 to n, but it depends on the index that we create here. Okay, we can just execute this code. So we have 3 items here, and each of the item will be 5, yeah, because like I was mentioning before, we have 3 items and all of the item will be 5, yeah. And the index is 100, and the index are 100, 200, and 300. So we can create our index, yeah, custom index. Okay, the next one is series as generalized NumPy array. Series objects basically interchangeable with a one-dimensional NumPy array. So we can update the item inside our pandas series. It's similar with the NumPy. As long as yeah, we set the copy as a false or as a default value. And the essential difference is the presence of the index, while the NumPy array has an implicitly defined integer index used to access the values. The pandas series has an explicitly defined index associated with the values. Like I was mentioning before, we can create our index and not limited to integer index, we can also create a string index. So we will discuss it after this. The explicit index definition gives the series object additional capabilities. For example, the index need not be an integer that can consist of values of any desired type. Yeah. Okay. Go to the next slide. So for example, these are the example how to create our custom index with non-integer data type for the index. Yeah. So for example, here we have some item inside our pandas series. Yeah. So yeah, this one. So we create a data, yeah, as a pandas series, and the data will contain 4 items: 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, and 0.1. Sorry, 1.0, and the index will be A, B, C, and D. So these are not the integer index, but the string index, right? It's interesting, yeah, because we can also create a string index here. Okay, what about if we execute this code? It will give you the pandas series with string index. So how to access the index by using this string? How to access the item by using the string index? Yeah, it's similar with the NumPy variable. Yeah, for example, I want to access the item inside our data on index B, for example. So it will be 0.5, right? Other than that, we can also use a custom index with integer values. Yeah, it's similar with our previous code. It's similar with this, yeah, but all of the item in this code, yeah, will be 5. But in this example, we will create a pandas series with 4 items, and we will give the index as a 2, 5, 3, and 7. So these are the custom index, right? 2, 5, 3, and 7. It will not start from 0. Yeah, we can create our custom index here. Okay, series as specialized dictionary. A dictionary is a structure that maps arbitrary keys to a set of arbitrary values. And a series is a structure that maps type keys to a set of type values. So remember, in our previous discussion about the collection, we also have a dictionary. A dictionary will consist keys and values. So keys is similar with the index, right? And the values is similar with the item, because the basic component in our pandas is contained from the keys and values. Yeah, it's similar with the index and also the item. And this typing is important just as the type-specific compile code behind a NumPy array makes it more efficient than a Python list for a certain operation. The type information of a pandas series makes it much more efficient than Python dictionaries for certain operations. Yeah, we have some of the advantages if we use the pandas series to represent a dictionary, because the pandas series, yeah, the pandas variable, basically it contains from the keys and values. It's similar with the dictionary, right? Because the keys is not only integer, but also we can also use the string as an index. So it's similar with the keys in dictionary, right? So it will more efficient if you use the pandas to represent the dictionary. And we can also make the series as dictionary analogy even more clear by constructing a series object directly from a Python dictionary. Okay, so this is the example of how to create a dictionary by using the pandas series. So for example, here we create some of the dictionary. Yeah, it's similar with a regular dictionary in Python. So I will copy this code then. Okay, I will paste in my Google Colab. As you can see here, we have a population dictionary. It contains some of the item, some of the keys and values. We have what is it called? You can call it as a city, yeah. California, Texas, New York, and Florida, and Illinois. So these are the city, and also the keys will be the city, and the values will be the population number in on each city. So for example, California, it contains around 3 million something people, yeah, inside the California city. So this one is dictionary. We have a city as a keys and a population as the values. So after this, we convert this dictionary to a pandas series. So here, I forgot to execute this code. Okay, then I execute this code. Then we convert this dictionary to a pandas series. Yeah, so we can just follow the code in our slide here. So population, yeah, we create another variable as a population equal pd.series, and we have a parameter population here, population underscore dictionary, because this one is the variable, dictionary variable, that we want to convert as a pandas series. Okay, then after this, I will print the population series here. So as you can see here, we have a pandas series, yeah, pandas series that is formed from the dictionary variable, right? And there are some advantages if you use the series as a specialized dictionary. For example, we want to access the values inside our dictionary. For example, we can use the slicing method. So if I want to access the values from the Texas keys to Illinois keys, so we can use this code, this one, print population, and the index will start from Texas, yeah, Texas to Illinois, right? So this one is the code to get the items, to get the values, start from Texas to Illinois. So if we use the regular dictionary variable in Python, we cannot use this. We cannot use this code. But if we use the pandas series, yeah, it's possible to get the values by using the keys. Yeah, by using the keys, with represent the similar method in NumPy array. So for example, this one, we want to get the data from the Texas to Illinois. Population Texas Illinois. Oh, sorry, I forgot to add the square bracket. Yeah. Wait a minute. this one. Okay, we get the values start from Texas to Illinois, right? Yeah, it's similar with the NumPy indexing or slicing, but with a string index or string case. Okay, that's all from the series. The next one we'll discuss about the data frame.
Okay, now we will discuss about the data frame. A data frame is a two-dimensional data structure, and data is aligned in tabular fashion in rows and columns. Yeah, we can say that the data frame is a two-dimensional array. Yeah, it's similar with the two-dimensional NumPy array. And you can also think of it as an SQL table or a split sheet data representation. Yeah, it's like you have a data which is formed like a table. It has a rows and it has a columns. A pandas data frame can be created using the following constructor. So if you want to create a data frame, a variable using pandas, yeah, we can just use these quotes, pandas the data frame, and the first index, sorry, the first parameter will be the data, the two-dimensional array that we want to convert to the data frame, and the second parameter is index, and the third parameter columns, and the fourth parameters is the data type of the data frame, and the last one is the copy. Yeah, it's similar with the series that we have discussed earlier, but the difference is only from the third parameter, because here we have columns, we have the columns parameter. Okay, let's try to create a data frame variable. So for example, here we have a data, yeah, data equal sum of the two-dimensional array. Yeah? So we have the name, and also we can go, we can just say this is the age, yeah, the age of the Alex and the age of the Bob and the age of the clock, yeah, name and age. So for example, here we will create, we create a data variable which contains two dimensional array, then we convert it to a data frame using pandas. So here we have Alex and we have Bob and we have Clark. Yeah, it's like a two-dimensional array. Then to convert the data to a data frame, we can just use this code df equal pt to data frame, and the first parameter will be the data that we want to convert the to the data frame, and the columns. Yeah, here we have columns. Wait, we need to change this character because I copy directly from the PDF, so it has some error in my code. Okay. Okay. So we can create a new column here, because by default, if we create a two-dimensional NumPy array, or if we create a two-dimensional Python array, we don't have the columns parameter. So if we convert to the data frame, we can just add the columns on that two-dimensional array. So yeah, after we convert to the data frame, we can just execute this code and print the data frame. Okay, here you can see we have a two-dimensional array, we have a data frame which also has the column name and age, right? But this one, 0, 1, and 2, actually this is the default index. Yeah, so if we create a data frame, by default we have a default index here, but we can just use this code. Yeah, so we can just don't care about the default index here, and we can just say we have a two columns only, name and age. Okay, And you can also create a data frame from the dictionary. Yeah, it's similar with the dictionary in Python dictionary, and we can also create a data frame from the dictionary. So yeah, we can just copy this one. Yeah, okay, print df. So here we have a dictionary, right? We have A and B, and we have also B and C here. But actually, we have two rows here. This one is the first rows, and this one is the second rows. But actually, we have a different columns between the first rows and second rows. In the first rows, we only have two columns, A and B, as a columns for the rows one. But for the rows two, we only have B and C. So actually, the first rows didn't have the C columns, but the second rows have didn't have A columns. And if we execute this code, then the first rows will be the C columns for the first rows will be not a number, right? And for the second rows, yeah, for the second rows, because the second rows didn't have the A column, so the value for the A columns will be not a number. Okay. So, okay, let's move to the next slide. So yeah, a data frame from a dictionary of series object. If a series is an analog of one dimensional array with flexible indices, a data frame is an analog of a two dimensional array with both flexible row indices and flexible columns names. Yeah, because in data frame we have a two parameters here. We have rows and we also have columns. So we have a two index here, and that two index also flexible. It's similar with the rows. It's similar with the index in series object. Just as you might think of a two dimensional array as an ordered sequence of aligned one dimensional columns, you can think of data frame as a sequence of aligned series object. Yeah, you can also think that the data frame is formed by two series objects, two or more series objects. Yeah, because one series, we can say that is a one rows, right? If we have more than two series, yeah, it means we have more than two rows. Yeah, and we can create a data frame by using two different series, two or more different series objects. And here by align, we mean that they share the same index. Yeah. So yeah, for example, here we have area dictionary, and we have California, Texas, New York, Florida, and Illinois. Yeah, it's similar with our first series that we have created before. We have population dictionary here, right? And the next one, yeah, we will create a area dictionary. So area dictionary and also population dictionary will share the same index, right? They share the same index, the city, right? California, we have California in the population dictionary, and we also have the California in area dictionary. And the differences between the area dictionary and population dictionary is only from its values, yeah? Because population dictionary, it represents the number of the population in California. But in area dictionary, the values will represent the area, the wide area of the city. Okay, so you can just copy this code, then yeah, we can combine the population dictionary and also area dictionary to one data frame. Yeah, so yeah, let's add another code cell here. Okay, we already have the area dictionary, then we convert the array dictionary to pandas series. So we can just use this code. Array dictionary equal pd.series, then the parameter will be array dictionary. So we don't need to add another parameters. We only have array dictionary here. And then after that, we create another variable here. We create a data frame, right? We create a data frame, and we create a new variable state. Yeah, This is the data frame. And like I was mentioning before, it contains two series object. Yeah. The first series object will be population, right? So we can just type population. Then the values will be population. Then for the second series object, we use the area. Then we give the values as area. Okay. Then after this, we print the states variable. So it will create a new data frame variable. So wait. Okay. Yeah. I do the wait. PD.data frame area. Oh, sorry. This one is not area dictionary, but area. Okay. So we create a new data frame, which has two columns, population and area. So when we create a data frame variable here, we give the column on this states, right? Population and also area. Okay. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Yeah, like the series object, the data frame has an index attribute that gives access to the index labels. So for example, if I want to know the index of the states, yeah, the index of the states. So it means I want to know the index, it means the index that represent the rows, each rows, California, Texas, New York, Florida, and Illinois. So yeah, we can just print only the index, yeah, the index attribute of the states. Okay, if we print states.index, it will print only the index that represent the rows, not the columns. And you can also print another information here, because like I was mentioning before, if we create the data frame, we have two index, rows and columns, and the second index will be the columns. Then if we want to know the columns of our data frame, then we can just print states.columns. Okay, then we will get the columns name of our data frame. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So the series and the data frame, yeah, we discuss another topic here. We go to the pandas index object, yeah. We didn't discuss a data frame anymore. So we discuss about the pandas index object. So what is pandas index object, yeah? The series and data frame object contain an explicit index that lets you reference and modify data. Yeah, series and data frame has their own index. So because a series and data frame have explicit index, so we can update the values or the item inside the inside our series or data frame variable. So the index object is an interesting structure in itself, and it can be thought of either as an immutable array or as an ordered set. Technically, a multi-set as index object may contain repeated values. So it means we can represent the index as a array. Yeah, it's similar with array, but it's a immutable array. You know, immutable array is an array, but we cannot update the item inside that array. So we can create the pandas index object. Yeah, to represent we can use the pandas index object to represent the item inside our series of data frame. Okay, this views have some interesting consequences in the operation available on index object. So we can after this we will discuss what is the function of the pandas index object. But before that, let's see about the code how to create the pandas index object. So here we create a pandas index object. We create IND variable then equal pd.index, then we create an array here. Yeah, for example, we give the values as 2, 3, 5, 7, 2, 3, 5, 7, and 11, and we can just print the IND variable. On this one, use the capital letter for the I. Okay, so we have the pandas index object here. So the next one is, yeah, what is the function of pandas index object? So before we discuss it, so let's see how to get the items inside our pandas index object. It's similar with the regular NumPy array or regular Python array, yeah. So we can call the item inside our variables inside our one-dimensional array or pandas index object by using, yeah. For example, here we want to get the item, yeah, 2, 5, and 11. So we can just use IND, and inside the square bracket we can just type colon colon and 2, yeah. So the first parameter will be the start number, the start index, and the second parameter will be the stop index, and the last parameter will be the steps. Yeah, it's similar with the NumPy array. Yeah, the index in the NumPy array. So index object also have many of the attributes familiar from NumPy arrays. Yeah, so we can just print the size, the shape, the dimension, and also the data type. So we can just skip this code. Yeah, because you already know when you learn about the NumPy array. But the differences, one differences between the pandas index object and the NumPy array is this one, because we cannot change the values, we cannot change the item inside our pandas index object. Like I was mentioning before, pandas index object is an immutable array. Immutable array, it means we cannot change the item inside our arrays. So if we type this code, yeah, because this one is change the item inside our pandas index object in index one, so it will give you the error message. Okay, so we can just move to the next slide. So pandas object are designed to facilitate operations such as joins across data sets, which depend on many aspects of set arithmetic. So yeah, the index object follows many of the conventions used by Python's built-in set data structure, so that unions, intersection, differences, and other combination can be computed. So it means, yeah, if you use the pandas index object, we can execute some of the arithmetic operations such as unions, intersection, differences, and etc. For example, here we have two pandas index object. Yeah, yeah, we can just copy this code then execute to our Google Colab. So this one, we have INDA and INDP. These two variable is a pandas index object. So if you want to do some of the arithmetic operations such as unions, intersection, and differences, yeah. So for example, here we can the first example, we can do the intersection operation. Intersection operation, so it means, yeah, with I will execute this code first. Okay, the intersection will give you the intersection operation between INDA and INDP. So it means we only get the number which is contained in INDA and INDP. 3, 5, and 7 is located in INDP and INDA. Yeah, so it means we get the intersection values. And the union, so it means we will make INDA and INDP as a new variable which contain all of the values in INDA and INDP. So this one, 1, 2, 3, 5, 7, 9, and 11. So we don't print the 3 numbers two times, yeah, because yeah, you know, the union operation will not print, yeah, will not print the same number in INDA and INDP. And the last one is symmetric difference, yeah, so it means we only get the values which is not in INDA but it exists in INDP. So symmetric differences between INDA and INDP will be 1, 2, 9, and 11. Okay, so we can also use another code here to intersect, yeah, two pandas index object. Yeah, we can use the intersection method. INDA.intersection, and we give the INDP as a parameters. Yeah, so yeah, it's similar. The output will be similar with the intersection. Okay, we can just skip this one.
Okay, next we are going to learn about the data indexing and selection. So what is data indexing? And yeah, we start from the data selection in series. A series built on this dictionary-like interface and provides array style item selection via the same basic mechanism as numByArrays, that is slices, masking, and fancy indexing. Yeah, we already know that the series in Pandas also have what is called is also have the index, yeah, the index, and also it's the index is similar with the keys and the values in dictionary, so we can call it as a dictionary like interface. And here some example of the data selection in Pandas series. Yeah, so we create a data variable and it contains four items. Yeah, it contains 0.25, 0.5, and so on and so on. And we give the index as A, B, C, and D. Then after that, we can get the data. We can select the data from the index A to index C. So it means we start from index A to index C. Index C is included, not excluded, right? Then we can also use indexing by using the integer values, start from 0 to 2. Yeah, if we use this kind of indexing, so we can get the 0.25 and 0.5. Yeah, so it means we only get from the index 0 and index 1, and index 2, 0.75 is excluded. Yeah, it's different if we use the integer indexing values. We start from the 0 and the top values is excluded. And the another example is this one. We can also use some of the conditions in indexing. So for example, we only get the item which are greater than 0.3 and less than 0.8, and we can get the 0.25 and also 0.75, like this one, right? Okay. Oh, sorry, we will get the 0.5 and 0.75. And you can also use the fancy indexing, yeah? So if you want to get the item which is, the index is A and E, so we will get the 0.25 and also not a number, because in our data, under series, we don't have the E items. Okay, we can just copy this code and try to our Google Colab. So we add another code here. So yeah, okay, I will just copy in from the slide, yeah, the code. So okay, so let me paste the code. Okay. So these are the example of the data selection in Pandas series. So we can just execute this code. Wait, E not in index. Okay, yeah, it should give us the not a number, right? So wait a minute, I will check it first. Let me comment this code first. Okay, it will give you some of the values similar with the slide, right? But if we print this data, okay, I think this one is, it will give you the error message, right? Different with the values in the slide, yeah? But let me check the code. Okay, what about if I remove the E index? It should give us 0.25, right? Okay. So I think it's different with the slide. So I will check it first, yeah, and then if I get the answer, I will give you further information about this. Yeah. So let me skip this code first. Maybe if I try to Anaconda or Anaconda or Jupyter Notebook, it will give the same values with the slide. But actually, I will try after this. Yeah, I will give you the further information in our live class in Tuesday. So let me skip this code first. So we move on to the next slide. So we can use some of the indexer attributes like LOC, ILOC, and IX. Yeah. Slicing may be the source of the most confusion. Notice that when you are slicing with an explicit index, for example, data with the A index to the C index, yeah, these are the explicit index, yeah. The final index is included in the slice. So it means the final index, the C, is included in the slice. So we will get the items from the index A to index C. Yeah, different with the NumPy array indexing. So yeah, we will discuss it after this. Well, when you're slicing with an implicit index, for example, data from 0 to 2, yeah, from index 0 to index 2, the final index is excluded from the slice, and the two index will be excluded, like I was mentioning before. Yeah, it's different because if we use the explicit index, the final index will be included. But if you use the implicit index by using the integer values as an index, so the final index will be excluded. Because of this potential confusion in the case of integer indexes, Pandas provides some special indexer attributes that explicitly expose certain indexing schemes. These are not functional methods, but attributes that expose a particular slicing interface to the data in the series. So that's why we will discuss about the log, ILOG, and IX. Yeah, we will discuss it one by one. First, we discuss about the log. Yeah, the log attribute allows indexing and slicing that always reference the explicit index. So when we want to use the explicit index, yeah, so we should use the log. So for example, we create a data variable. Then after this, we create a data variable as a pandas series. It contains A, B, and C items, and we keep the index as a 1, 3, and 5. Then after that, if you want to get the data, yeah, in index 1 using LOC, so it will give you A, not B, because we use the explicit index, right? And we can also use the data.log 1, colon 3, so it means it will give you the values from index 1 to index 3, and index 3 is included, not excluded, because we are using the log, not ILOG. Yeah, it's different with the ILOG. We'll discuss it after this. So if you want to use the final index included in our slicing, so we should use the log, right? The next one is ILOG. The ILOG attribute allows indexing and slicing that always references the implicit Python style index. But we can also use the ILOG. ILOG is similar with the indexing or slicing in regular Python NumPy array. So the final index, yeah, the final index will be excluded if we are using the ILOG method, right? For example, 1, 2, 3. So it means we don't use the index from the pandas series, but actually we will use the regular Python index. So we will start from 0 to M. It depends on the number of the item in our pandas series. So it means we have three items, right? We have three items. If we want to start to get the items from index 1, so it means it reference to index 3, right? So it will give you the B item through index 3. So it means the index 3 is excluded because we don't have the index 3, right? Like here, right? We only have index 0, 1, and 2. So it means it will give you B and C because we will get the values from the index 1 to index 2. We use the regular Python NumPy slicing, not pandas series slicing. Yeah, that is the difference between LOC and ILOC. What about the IX? Yeah, we'll discuss it after this. So yeah, let me just copy this code for the lock and ILOC. Yeah, so I will copy the code first. So let me add another code here. Okay, print data LOC 1 and print data LOC 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Okay. Okay, this is the example of the LOC method, and you can also use the ILOC. It will give you the similar method in Python NumPy indirect indexing. Okay, it will give you B and B and C, right? Okay, so continue to the next slide. A third indexing attribute IX is a hybrid of the two, and for a series object is equivalent to standard square bracket space indexing. The purpose of the IX indexer will become more apparent in the context of data frame. So the IX attribute, we will use it for the indexing in data frame pandas series. Actually, in data frame pandas, yeah, pandas data frame. So it will more useful if you use the IX in data frame or two-dimensional pandas series, yeah. So the IX is the combination between the LOC and ILOC. Okay, let me give you the example after this. So one guiding principle of the Python code is that explicit is better than implicit. The explicit nature of the LOC and ILOC make them very useful in maintaining clean and readable code, especially in the case of integer indexers. I recommended using this code to make code easier to read and understand and to prevent subtle bugs due to the mixed indexing or slicing convention. Okay. Let's listen to our example of area and population states. Yeah. So the individual series that make up the columns of the data frame can be accessed via dictionary style indexing of the column name. So for example, we already have the states, right? The state data frame, right? So for example, we print the state in the area column, only for the area column. So let me write the code first. Print state area. Okay, it will give you the area of the of each the city, yeah. Then after that, yeah, this dictionary style syntax can also be used to modify the object, in this case to add a new column. So for example, we can add another code here. So let me explain this one, yeah, because we will explain about the IX after this, yeah. This one is not the example of the IX indexer, so we will discuss it the IX after this. So let me continue my explanation first. So this one, we can create another. Let me copy this code first. We create another column here. So for example, the step with the density columns. Yeah, we don't have the density columns right now, but we will create another column and we give the values for the density column as a result from the state population divided by the area, right? So the density, it means the calculation between the population divided by the area. Then after we execute this code, we will get another column. We will get a new column and we can call it as a density column. Okay, let me execute this code first. Then before we execute this code, we only have the population and area column, but after we execute this code, so we create another column that is a calculation between the population divided by area, then this one is the new column, right? And we can also transposing the data frame, so it's similar with the matrix transpose, right? So the column will be the rows and the rows will be the column, yeah. we can exchange between the column and the rows by using the transpose method. So in the pandas series, it will give you a feature for transposing the data frame. So how to transpose the data frame? So we can just use the name of the variable that we want to transpose, and we call the T feature. We call the T attribute like this. If we execute this code, as you can see here, we get the transposing data frame from the state, right? So the column will be in the rows and the rows will be in the column. Okay. After we transposing the data frame, yeah, we still be able to indexing the data frame using the ILOC and also the L and also the log and also the IX, yeah, the indexer. We will discuss it after this. So for example, here we want to get the item by using the ILOC. Okay, then we want to get the rows from start from the zero index to index, yeah, because the three is excluded because we are using the ILOC of LOC. So yeah, so this one is the example of the ILOC. So if I can check this code, yeah, it will give you the rows start from 0 to 3 and start from 0 to 2 and the column start from 0 to 1, right? Okay. And we can also use the log, yeah. We can just skip this code, yeah. We can just read from the slide. So we can also get the values, get the item by using the LOC method, yeah. So the example of this code is it will give you the rows start from, yeah, start from California to Florida, yeah, because the LOC, the top, the final index will be included, and also the population, yeah, because the population is the first column, so we will get only one column here. Okay, and what about the IX, yeah? Okay, the IX is a combination between LOC and ILOC. So it means if you want to use the ILOC for the rows indexing, and we want to combine with the LOC method for the column indexing. Okay, let me explain to you. So this one is the IX indexer. So it means it will give you on the item start from start from the index 0 to index 2, yeah, because the tree will be excluded, right? 0 to 2, 0 1 2, and also the population. So it means the population will use the LOC, not the ILOC, and the rows will use the ILOC, and the column will use the LOC. So the IX indexer is useful when we want to combining the LOC and ILOC, because this one require two indexing. So the IX indexer only can be able to implement it in the JavaFrame variable in pandas. And keep in mind that for integer indices, the IX indexer is subject to the same potential sources of confusion as discussed for integer index series objects. Okay. And the LOC indexer, we can combine masking and fancy indexing as in the following example. So for example, this one is we print the states, yeah, the state which has the density greater than 100 and the population and density. So we want to get only the population and density column. So we can use the LOC. Okay. Okay, let me copy the code first, then it will give you the item in the Florida population and also New York population. Okay. Okay. Oh, sorry. I copied the wrong code here. Okay, so we will get the item which has the density greater than 100 and The city will be the New York and Florida, and the columns, we print the columns only for the population and also the density. Okay. Any of these indexing convention may also be used to set or modify values. So we are not only use the indexing for the getting the items or slicing the item from the data frame. You can also use the indexing for updating or modifying the values of the item in our data frame. Yeah, this is done in the standard way that you might be accustomed to form a working with NumPy. It's similar with the modification item in NumPy. So for example, here we use the ILOC method, yeah, to modify the item in index 0 and index 2. So it means the density will be 90. Okay, let me tackle this purpose. Okay, so we modify the density in California City, right? So we can also use the ILOC, LOC, and IX indexer for modifying the values in our data frame.
Okay, now we will discuss about the operating on data in Pandas. So one of the essential pieces of NumPy is the ability to perform quick element-wise operations, but with basic arithmetic such as addition, subtraction, and also multiplication, and with more sophisticated operations such as trigonometric function, exponential, and logarithmic function. So it means in the Pandas libraries, we can also use some of the basic arithmetic calculation and also some of the sophisticated operations such as trigonometric and function, and also exponential and logarithmic function. And Pandas inherits much of this functionality from NumPy. Yeah? So actually Pandas also have ufunks. Yeah? So it means we can use the ufunction that is provided by NumPy to calculate, yeah, to calculate some of the calculation in Pandas libraries. And in Pandas includes a couple useful twists. Wherefore, for unary operation like negation and trigonometric function, this U function will preserve index and column labels in the output. And for binary operation such as addition and multiplication, Pandas will automatically align indices when passing the objects to the U function. So yeah, we will try some of the example after this. And this means, yeah, and that keeping the context of the data and combining data from different sources, but potentially error-prone tasks with raw NumPy arrays become essentially foolproof ones with Pandas. Okay, for example, here we create a new variable, yeah, and we can give the name as a RNG equal np.random.randomState, yeah. So we create a Pandas series which contain random variables, random items, from 0 to 9, yeah, and we create 4 items inside this SER variables. And we can also create a new data frame, yeah. So the data frame also use the random function, start from 0 to 9, and we give this the size of this data frame 3 times 4. So we will have 3 rows and 4 columns. And we give the column as A, B, C, and D. Okay. So let me type this code. So we create a one series and one data frame. One series and one data frame. Then we print first, we print the series first, yeah, SER. So it will give you 4 items inside the SER variables, which is, yeah, start from 0 to 9, yeah, 6, 3, 7, and 4. This one is not the values. This is the index, yeah, not these values. And we can also print the data frame. So we have 3 rows and 4 columns. And the items also start from 0 to 9. Yeah. Okay, so we can use some of the U functions provided by NumPy. For example, we call the log method, right? The log method. So for example, I want to know the log values from my data frame. So we can just type np.log, and for this parameter, we can pass the df variable. And if I execute this code, so it will give you the log values from the data frame items. And this one is the U function, yeah. So it means it will give you more efficient in terms of computational time. So we can use the U function from NumPy to calculate, yeah, to do the some of the basic arithmetic operation in the data frame and also in the series. Okay, for binary operations on two series or data frame objects, pandas will align indices in the process of performing the operation. And this is very convenient when you are working with incomplete data. So for example, this is the series. We have two series, area and population. And the area, it will have the Alaska, Texas, California, yeah, as a case values. As a case, and this one is the area of the Alaska, Texas, and California. And we give the name of this series as a area. And we can also have another series here. We have a population. As we can see here, we also have some of the city, yeah, California, Texas, New York. But actually, area and population has a different cities. Yeah. For example, in the area, we have Alaska, but in population, we don't have Alaska. But in population, we have New York, but in the area, we don't have New York. And if we want to combine these two series, yeah, so if you want to calculate some of the calculation from the area and population, for example, I want to know the density between the population and area. So it means, for example, California, I want to know the density of the California. It means to calculate the density, we must divide population by area. But because in the population, we don't have Alaska, right? We don't have Alaska population number, but in the area we have Alaska, right? So if we calculate the density of the Alaska, it will give you not a number values because we don't have the Alaska population number of the Alaska. So yeah, let me execute this code. So if we don't have the case from one series, but we want to calculate that series, yeah, by dividing with another series, so it will give you not a number values. Okay. Okay, it will give you not a number values, right? Okay, the next one is if using not a number values is not the desired behavior. If you don't want to receive or get the not a number values, we can modify our code, yeah. We can modify the field values using appropriate object methods in place of the operators. So for example, this one, we have a two series again, A and B, and the A will have 3 items, 2, 4, and 6, and B also have 3 items, 1, 3, and 5. And the index for the A, 0, 1, 2, and the index for B is 1, 2, and 3. If we want to add A by B, if we want to add A and B, yeah, it will give you not a number values in the index 0. Why? Because the index 0 only located in the A variables, but in the B variable, we don't have the 0 index, right? So it will give you not a number values. How to solve this problem if you don't want to get the not a number variable? So we can add the another parameter here. So we add the fill underscore value parameters equal 0. So it means if we don't have the 0 index in the B variable, it will add the 0 values for the index 0. So it means we have the 2 values, right? We have 2 values. If we add to the B variable, because the in the B variable we don't have the zero index, so the two values will add by zero, so it will give you the two values here. Okay, so yeah, if we don't want to get the not a number values, so we can add another parameter fill underscore value equals zero, so it will add a zero values to each the item, right, that don't have the same index, right? Okay, and then print A at B, and also A at B with the fill underscore value parameters equal zero. So the last one is the handling missing data. So what is handling missing data? So the differences between data found in many tutorials and data in the real world is that real world data is really clean and homogeneous. Yeah, we can say that the real data will not clean as our assumption. So actually we need to pre-process the data, so it will make our data more clean. So we can process the data after we cleaning the data first. In particular, more interesting data set will have some amount of data missing. To make matters even more complicated, different data sources may indicate missing data in different ways. And pandas provide us with several useful methods for handling missing data. For example, we have some of the method in pandas is null, not null, drop null, and fill null. So we will discuss it one by one after this. So here we create a data, yeah, data variable. It is a pandas series variable, and as you can see here, we create a data. It is a series pandas series, and it has four items: one, not a number, hello, and num. So actually, in pandas series, we can create a series which contain the item which has a different data type. Yeah, it's okay if we have more than one items in our pandas series and also have a different data type. And for example, this one, we can just execute this code. Yeah, so this is the pandas series, data pandas series. We have four items here, and if you want to know which one of the data which is null, so it means null, we can say that np dot not a number, it's a null, and also non, it's also a null item. So we can use the is null method, then it will give you false and true output. And the opposite of the is null is not null. If we execute this code, it will give you a true and false value also, but it will give you the true, it will give you that this item is not a null variable. Okay, so we can also use this code. Yeah, so actually if we want to know which item which is not null, so we can just use the data which data dot not null as a index. Yeah, so it will give you the true, yeah, true for the index 0 and true for the index 2. So it will give you the item in index 0 and index 2. And you can also use the drop null method. So it means it will drop the null value, because in index 1, index 3 is the null value. So it will be dropped from our data pandas series. So what about if we have the data frame? Yeah, we can also use the drop null in. We can also use the drop null in the data frame. So for example, here we create a data frame. Yeah, which contain three rows and three columns. And this is the data from rows 0, rows 1, and rows 3. Then if we print this code, then it will give you some of the data frame variables. So if you want to use the dropna in our data frame, so for example, we can just call the dropna. So it will give you on the rows that is not contained the not a number values. We can say that the index 0, rows 0 and rows 2 contain a not a number item. So it will not be printed if we use the dropna method. Okay. But what about if we want to using the dropna in the columns side? So it means we can also use this one, but we need to give another parameter here. So the axis, by default, the axis will be 0. But if we change the axis to 1, so it will remove the rows. I'm sorry, it will remove the columns that contain the not a number values. Okay. Okay, sorry, this one is actually inside the method dropna. The parameters axis equal 1. Okay, so it will remove the column that contains not a number values. But if we want to add some of the parameters here, actually, if we want to, if we use the dropna, if we use the dropna, it will drop not a number item inside our data frame, but we can also use the how parameters. So it means if we add the how parameters equal all, so it will remove all of the rows because we use the axis equal one. I'm sorry, not rows but column. If we use the how equal all, so it means it will remove the rows and the column that contains the not a number value. So for example, the three columns contain not a number values. All of the item inside column 3 contain not a number values. If we use the how equal all, so it means it will only remove the column that is contain all of the not a number values. Okay, but in column 0 and column 1, we only have one not a number values, so it will not be removed from our data frame. Okay, so yeah. Okay, for example, this one, we execute this code, so we print this data frame. Yeah, we know that the column 3, all of the item in column 3 are not a number values. So if we want to remove all of the item inside our three columns, yeah, columns 3, so we need to add the how parameters, so equal all. Okay, if we by default, the how will be any. The default value, the how parameters is any, not all. Okay. So we also be able to add another parameters. So for example, we add the threshold parameters. So it means if our rows or columns contains not a number values which has some threshold. So for example, this one, we add the 3 as a threshold. So it means if we have a rows or column that contain more than two not a number values, it will be removed from our data frame. Okay, so for example here, we still use the data frame, this one. So for example, this one is we add another code here. Okay, this one, yeah, we use the axis equal 0, so it means we will search by using the rows, right? So for example, rows 0 contains 2 not a number values, and also rows 2 contains 2 not a number values. So it will be removed from our data frame because we use the 3 as a threshold. So it means the maximum value of the not a number is 2. If our rows contain 2 not a number values, so it will be removed from our data frame. Okay, so I just execute this code. So it will give you only the rows 1. What about if we use the axis equal 1? So it means we will search by using the columns, right? So it will remove the columns that contains not a number values, right? Okay. Okay. Let's go to the next slide. So yeah, sometimes rather than dropping an A values, you'd rather replace them with a valid value. This value might be a single number like zero, or it might be some sort of the imputation or interpolation from the good values. So for example, here we create another series, and yeah, this one is the series that we create. We have of 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. We have 5 items, and we know that in our B index and D index is not a number values. So we execute this code, then we can use the fill num method. So it means if we have the item which is not a number value, so it will replace by a zero values. So fill number with the method zero, yeah, we give the zero as a parameters here, so all of the not a number values will be replaced by the zero values. And you can also use the f fill, so it means it will change, yeah, it will update the item, the not a number item, by using the previous rows. So we have in index P we have a not a number, and the previous number in index A is 1. So it means if you use the f fill method, so it will replace by our previous values. So the P will be 1. And also in index D we have not a number values, and the previous index, which is index C, is a 2.0 values. So it will be changed. Yeah, the not a number values in index D will be changed by the 2 values. And you can also use the pfill method. So it means it will use the next number, the next values. So for example, here we have a not a number in index P. So the next number in index C is a 2. So it means the index P, not a number in index P, will be replaced by 2. And it is also happen in index D. Okay. Okay, that's all from our discussion for this on this video. So we will discuss some of the problem. If you have a problem, if you have a question, yeah, we can discuss it in our live class next Thursday. Okay, thank you for your attention. So I will end this video.